To ensure that the data is secure at rest and in transit, we will have to encrypt data in the database and encrypt data when we send data over the internet. So before learning about database encryption and encrypt data during transit, we are going to be learning about the encryption algorithm first. So the encryption algorithm has three different types. The first type is called symmetric encryption algorithm. The second is called asymmetric encryption algorithm. And the third is the hashing algorithm. So let's take a look at each of them. For the symmetric encryption algorithm, we are going to be using like symmetric key. So this symmetric key can be considered as a shared secret. It means that all the parties involved in the sending and receiving message will use the same key. And this same key will be used to encrypt and decrypt message. So this is like a simple key that we have seen earlier. One of the symmetric key algorithm is CISA algorithm, where you the key is the number where you can shift the text. For example, if we have the word cats, for example, cat C-A-T, right? And when we want to message, to send message and you want to encrypt and the key is one, so you shift the word by one letter. So from C, it will become D. From A, will become B, T will become U. So this is a very simple encryption algorithm where you just shift a letter by the number in the key. To decrypt is easier. You just shift it back. So you use the same key, which is one. But in modern cryptography, the algorithm is much more complex than that. So when you use symmetric key algorithm, we need to use key that has the large size. When the key is the large size, it is very difficult to break using the modern algorithm based on mathematics. The symmetric key algorithm is usually used to perform encryption of large amount of data because it's fast, and it only provide confidentiality. It does not provide, it doesn't tell you or who sent the message, but it just hide the content of the message. The symmetric key algorithm sometimes is called secret key cryptography because the key should be kept secret. Sometimes it's also called private key cryptography because the key should be kept in private. To encrypt and decrypt, it will follow this diagram. So you have you want to send from P to C. So to send, so this is the data that you want to encrypt. So you use the key, supply the key to encryption algorithm, and then you're gonna get the encrypted data. To decrypt, you use the decrypted the encrypted data, and then you use decryption algorithm with the same key, and then you're gonna get the plain text. So this is like it's very simple approach. But symmetric key algorithm has several weaknesses. First, the key distribution is a major problem. Since everyone has to share the same key, so how are we gonna distribute the key to the parties involved? When you distributed the key, you might have to, you know, send over the network and it can be intercept. So it's quite, it is a problem, but there are solutions to it, and we will learn about it in a bit. And there is no way to prove given where the given message originated. So we don't know who sent the message. And it's not scalable, because if you want to keep the conversation private, for each pair of user, you might have to have like each key for each pair, right? So if a number of user increase, a number of key increases, it's quite polynomially, so it will not quite scalable. And the key must be regenerated often. If you know someone leave the group and they know the key, right? So the chair key, so we have to regenerate it. Or if you think that the key has been tampered, then you have to change it. But the major strength for the symmetric key algorithm is that it's very, very fast. It's usually 10 or 1 or 10,000 times faster than the asymmetric algorithm. Now let's take a look at the asymmetric key algorithm, see how it works. So in the asymmetric key algorithm, there is a pair of key. So there's two keys. First is a public key, which is let's say if Alice want to send data to Bob, you know, Alice will have two key, Alice public key and Alice private key, right? So the Alice public key can be shared with like all other users, but for private key of Alice has to be kept secret and only known by Alice. So to encrypt and decrypt, we have to use a pair of private public private key. So what you do is that here you have a sender and you have a plain text. To encrypt, we encrypt by using the receiver public key, right? So since the public key of everyone is published, is known, so you have to find public key of the receiver and then encrypt the data with that. And then you got the encrypted text. And then you send the text to the receiver. When the receiver receive the encrypted text, he will decrypt algorithm using his own private key, right? So his own private key, and then you can decrypt data. So as you can see that, to encrypt and decrypt data, you have to use public and private key of the receiver. Encrypt using receiver public key and decrypt using the receiver private key, because this is the only key that is known by the receiver. The asymmetric key algorithm is also called public key algorithm because it uses part of the key is public. We should not confuse with the private and public key in the asymmetric key algorithm. The name is not exactly good name because it could be confusing, but they are using it like this. So we should know and we should be careful when we talk about public key cryptography. So one benefit of the asymmetric key algorithm is that it also provides support for digital signature technology. So to do the digital technology, we can sign the data. To sign the data, we switch this picture. So to sign the data, we will the sender will encrypt using sender private key. So this is to sign data, not to encrypt. To sign data, you use the sender private key, and the receiver can use the sender public key to, you know, decrypt data. So now the sender, the receiver know who sent the data, because the receiver must use the correct public key to encrypt data, right? And that will tell you who sent the data. So asymmetric key algorithm is very very useful in for the digital signature technology. And the asymmetric key algorithm is also scalable because you only need each user only need to use a pair of key, so it's linear to the number of user. So here let's compare the number of key required when the number of participants increases. So here let's take a look at the this is like the formula to completely connect N party using symmetric key cryptography. So that means that if you have four parties, 4 × 3 = 12 divided by 2, so 6, right? So for you need 6 key, because you for each connection you need a key. So if you take a look at this number, as the number of participants increases, the number of symmetric key will increases in like the square of n. But for the number of symmetric key, asymmetric key required, it's only linear because it's just twice as much as the number of participants. So it is the asymmetric key algorithm is much more scalable than the symmetric key one. The major strength is that it is scalable, and when you remove user from the group, you can just invalidate the user key, and the key regeneration is required only if that particular user is compromised. And it also provide integrity, authentication, and non-repudiation. So it provide digital signature, that is. And the key distribution is so simple. You just, for each one who want to participate, you just make their public key available. But the major weakness is that it's very, very slow. So usually we use symmetric key and asymmetric key together. In one of the situation that we use asymmetric key algorithm to distribute symmetric key, and then you use symmetric key to encrypt data. So this is one way to use the two algorithms together. So let's do some summary for the comparison for the symmetric and asymmetric cryptography system. So for symmetric, it's a single share key, but for asymmetric, there's gonna be a key pair, public and private. And this is not, the symmetric is not scalable. Asymmetric is scalable. The encryption and decryption for symmetric is very fast, but asymmetric is very low. And so that's why we encrypt, we can encrypt large amount of data using symmetric key. But usually for asymmetric key, we only encrypt small block of data and use mostly for digital signature or digital certificate. And asymmetric only provide confidentiality to high data. For asymmetric, in addition to high data, it can provide like digital signature as well. So it tells you who are the original message sender. Next, there is also a hashing function. A hashing algorithm is used to generate hash. A hash sometimes is called message digest. The hash or message digest are a summary of message content. So the hashing algorithm, one important feature is that it is a one-way function. So usually we only encrypt and we do not decrypt data. So it means that it's extremely hard to determine the input when you provide the output, meaning if you have the encrypted data, it's very hard to go back to the plain text. And we use the hashing algorithm for different purpose than the symmetric and asymmetric key. You usually use this for like password hashing because you don't want to know the original content, right? And or you use hashing to maybe condense the size of the data, stuff like that. And we have learned the hashing algorithm already in the password hashing lecture. So in the hashing algorithm, we have like MD5, char, the PBKDF2, and bcrypt and scrypt. Next, we're gonna learn about the algorithm of the symmetric key cryptography. There are a couple algorithms such as the DES, triple DES, IDEA, Blowfish, and AES. So let's take a look at each of them. For the DES, DES stands for Data Encryption Standard. This one is quite old. It's from 1977, and it was like a standard cryptography back then. But nowadays, DES is no longer considered secure because there is some flaw in the algorithm. And nowadays, they use like AES instead. So the concept of DES is that it will operate on a 64-bit of plain text at a time. And for each, so if we have like a large amount of data, it will encrypt each 64-bit produce the cipher text, and then another 64-bit until end of the message. DES use a key that is 56-bit long, and it use like a long series of exclusive OR to generate cipher text. And this process, this generation of cipher text using XOR is gonna be repeated 16 times, and we usually call round. So we do it 16 rounds for each XOR, long XOR operation. So the DES is weak, so there is an adapt version of DES called triple DES. It uses the same algorithm as DES, but it just simply applied the encryption three times. There are four versions here. Here where E is the encryption function, K is a key, and P is a plain text. So here we apply it three times. So first we use like three key for simple version. For the key three, we do encryption first, and then the results of cipher text will be encrypted again with the another key, and then encrypted again with another key. Right. So this is the encryption is applied three times. There are more variants where instead of doing encryption, it does the decryption instead with the another key, right? So this is the second variant. Look like the first version, but instead of encrypt, it does the decryption instead. For the third version, instead of using like three key, one key is repeated. So we use like key one twice. For the fourth version, it's like the combination of second and third. So you use only key one and key two because key one used twice, and we do encryption in the middle. So this is like the triple DES. Next algorithm is called International Data Encryption Algorithm, or IDEA. This is developed because the DES used insufficient key length. Here, the IDE also operate on 64 block of plain text at a time. And now it use the longer key with 128 bits. Remember the DES use 56 bit. And IDEA key, this long key is broken up into 52 sub keys. Each sub key length is 16 bit. So, and then the sub key is then used to encrypt data using the XOR operation. So one popular implementation of IDEA is the PGP secure email package. We have seen this a bit. Next is the Blowfish algorithm. The Blowfish algorithm is created by Bruce Schneider. It's also operated on the 64-bit blocks of text. Here, it allows variable key length from the 32 bits to 444 bits. So you can choose like the insecure, but not as secure to an extremely secure data. However, the longer key will result in the increased time in encryption and decryption. However, Blowfish is still much faster than the IDEA or DES algorithm. Blowfish encryption is built into a number of commercial software and operating system, and the bcrypt that we have seen in hashing password is also based on Blowfish. The last encryption algorithm is called AES or Advanced Encryption Standard. This is the replacement of the DES, and it has the three level of key strength. You can choose which one you need: 128, 192, or 256. But it only operates on the 128 bit blocks. For each number of key length, it require different rounds of encryption like this. So nowadays AES is considered like a standard encryption algorithm. And now we focus on the symmetric key. Since the problem of symmetric key is the key distribution, there are three ways to exchange secret key securely. There's offline distribution, public key encryption, and Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. We're gonna take a look at each of them. So first is offline distribution. This is like a simple method where you do the physical exchange, like give key to in a sheet of paper, or you just save it into like a thumb drive, or you send it over an email or something like that. But the flaw in this offline distribution is that it can be intercepted. So we don't usually use this. So the second alternative is better. So what you do is that you use asymmetric key to establish connection, and then you use the asymmetric key encryption to encrypt the symmetric key, and then you send over the secure connection. And once the two party receive the shared symmetric key, they then switch communication to using this shared key to encrypt data to be much faster, right? So you use the asymmetric key to distribute the shared key or symmetric key. Lastly, there is key exchange algorithm called Diffie-Hellman. This is very interesting key exchange algorithm. The diagram is from Wikipedia. It summarizes how it works, but it actually based on complex like mathematics, like a modular of a number of key. But this picture should tell you a general idea of how it works. So here, if Alice and Bob want to communicate, and they want to get the share key. What they do is that Alice will use Bob's public key and Alice's private key to combine it into some data. And Bob will also use Alice's public key and Bob's private key with some way to combine data the same way. And the resulting key will be the same key. So Bob and Alice doesn't have to communicate prior than sending the data at all. They just use each other public key in combined with their own private key to create a combined share secret. This is a very interesting problem algorithm. You should take a look at the Wikipedia or Google to see how the mathematics actually works. So here is the overview of the encryption algorithm. And we are going to use AES. Usually we are going to use AES in the encryption of database. In the next video, we're going to be learning database encryption.